sought after business chamber offering all possible solutions under one umbrella. To further elaborate, many of us have new ideas but are looking for investing partners. That's exactly what the BPA session today is one of you all about. At the same time, many of us are looking to invest new ideas in this facet, especially designed for this particular subject, which we call We Create. So We Create basically programs also provides its members the benefit to get a successful franchisee module from its other members for exchanging business benefits and taking their respective ideas to bigger heights cumulatively. So basically, friends, we've discussed in this in our various forums, and I can see all the members, confirmed members here. So we know We Create, what is We Create? So it's about basically, in short, in one line, creating new business opportunities, and that's how we have our fellow ICBN member, Delhi, who's a partner to this project called Zilligence. So I'll quickly start about the We Create session, introducing them, so that then they come and take over for their presentation. So friends, Zilligence is an artificial intelligence driven B2B platform that helps optimize sales targeting. On the stage, we have on the August gathering here, we have two key representatives of Zilligence. I'll briefly introduce them. Mr. Manoj Madhusudan is the co-founder and CEO of Zilligence. Mr. Manoj has over 18 years of experience in research and consulting industry across India and the UK. He was the global head of operations at ValueServe, managing a team of more than 800 professionals across emerging economies. He also served as a management consultant at Accenture. Manoj is a B.Tech from IIT Madras and an MBA from Accelerai Jamshedpur. Wow. Thank you. We also have Mr. Ravi Baid, who's from Delhi and belongs to our roundtable fraternity. So many of us know what roundtable is. So he's from the same fraternity. So Mr. Ravi, along with Tushar Agarwal, who's the ICBN member from Delhi, has supported and incubated this company called Zilligence. So Ravi is a graduate from BITS Pilani and an MBA from University of Arizona, USA. So we have Ravi here with us. Thank you. So not taking much time and quickly wrapping up, so today we present the Zilligence as an investment opportunity on behalf of ICBI's We Create facet. So Zilligence is looking to raise about INR 40 million so in this current year. So friends, so that's a very brief introduction about Zilligence, and we have them, both of them, present their startup pitch, which would be approximately 10 minutes time, and then we follow it on with question answers, and by the time we expect Mr. Arun to join in by 4:10, 4:15 max. Thank you, friends. Thank you.
Thank you for the introduction. Before I start the pitch, I'll start the video, which I am told is a teaser video. In fact, this is the first public screening of the teaser video, which just got ready 3 days back. So here it goes.
You may be an expert shooter, but if you don't know where your best targets are, you are probably as good as a beginner. As a sales and marketing professional, you know that there are huge opportunities in doing business with emerging, fast-growing companies. But how do you target the best ones in motion of such firms? Do you scan through millions of small and mid-sized companies? Or would you like to go for a platform that helps you cherry-pick fast-growing firms? Zilligence helps you do just that. Zilligence is an AI-driven B2B platform that features thousands of well-funded and fast-growing companies. For each company, numerous data points are gathered and set by us to give you meaningful business insights on key metrics, developments, funding, and others. We provide multiple filters to build customized lists. To help you prioritize the targets, we also show you each company's relevance matched to your profile and its growth score. You can shortlist and connect with the companies you want to do business with. Want more? Ask for custom research for deeper insights. So what are you waiting for? Spot the next big thing before your competitor does with just a click. Try Zilligence today.
Thank you. So do I need to do Alright, so let me start. Thank you very much. Okay, so I have a bunch of slides here, but I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that. Just, just walk through that, because the whole idea, so that if you need any further information, we are here. We'll be very happy to have follow-up on the session also. So, we'll talk about the idea and product for a couple of minutes. What's the market for this? And who's behind it, the team, also the team that executes it? And what's the end roadmap? What's our ask? And what's our plan? So, I used to be at the Evangelist for the past 13 years, both in India and the UK. And one of my clients, he's the chief marketing officer for one of the real estate consulting firms, global ones. So, he mentioned that when Flipkart was a very small company, they put a lot of their time and energy in the company, invested in their efforts on selling to that company. And initially, of course, did not give much of us. But over time, that gave almost a 3.5 crores or $500,000 worth of annual revenues for this real estate company. So one of the big challenges that lots of sales marketing professionals face is there are so many emerging companies, like whether you look at internet of things, blockchain, biotechnology, transportation, logistics, so many companies coming up out there. How do you find the best ones that you want to focus your energy on, rather than wasting your money and time across companies that probably do not scale up, do not have the right kind of metrics, and companies that are not most relevant for you, right? For your business. For example, if you are a reseller, this is actually a live example from a company in Bangalore. They are a reseller of Apple products. So they're using diligence to find the best companies, for example, gaming companies. Of course, need high-end Mac machines, or animation companies need high-end Mac machines. So they're using diligence find the best fit companies that they can sell to. But if you don't know which are the best fit, there are so many animation companies, so many gaming companies, you'll be wasting your money and time chasing companies that are not worth chasing. That's what we're trying to solve here. So how do you find the best fit companies, the next big emerging companies? How do you filter out companies that are not relevant? And how do you connect them? For example, now even if you know this company is good, you need to start doing LinkedIn, you need to start doing a lot of Googling to find their email addresses, and then figure out a way to connect. It's not very efficient unless you have a very big CRM platform. So we want to solve that problem for all small and mid-sized companies globally. There are 125 million small and mid-sized companies that potentially can be targeted. So it's a pretty big market. I have a slide that says we have $8.8 billion global market out there to go after. But you know, there is no platform that really simplifies the task. For example, on Zilligence, for a $200 quarterly subscription, you could have access to all of this and connect with those companies. Right? So that's how we are kind of trying to disrupt that space. It comes, kind of comes at the cusp of the startup databases, right? And the typical lead generation tools. Now, when you look at these lead generation tools also, most of them are focused on the US market. For example, there's a company called Everstream. They are very good in looking at US companies, but outside of the US, they don't have this coverage. So if you look at Indian companies, Singaporean companies, general Asia companies, or African, North America, North Africa, Middle East, European, Latin American, there is a good platform out there, right? But being based in India, our vision is to actually build something which is global, much beyond the US, and create something which can really simplify the task of targeting emerging companies. Now, not just from a sales marketing point of view, that's one part of it, but you could also be looking for alliances. You're trying to incubate a company, or you are looking for M&A, right? How do you, for example, I know, Lightcase, a smart lighting company based in India, was looking for a partner in Europe, an internet of things company. They almost landed up tying up with a Swedish company which is about to go bankrupt. Right? So, unless you have a metrics which really shows a company's potential, you may end up wasting a lot of your time. Right? That's what you're doing. So, that's a long introduction to that, but I think it covers most of it. So, I'll just go very quick now on this. So, you know, you can check out Zilligence and, you know, you sign up for a free trial. But this is how it works. You can search for companies. You can look at companies and filter them by growth and relevance. So we use two scores. One is called Zilligence score, which is a combination of companies, last funding, its growth, employee growth, you know, any other metrics that you can find, social media growth, the recent news, for example, what are the kind of sentiments that you're getting from the news? Is this company expanding or are there legal troubles with this company? So you look at all of that and kind of figure out the score for each company, which is the Zillinger score. Now, Zillinger score is a unique score for a company. Second is your relevance score. Now, it's like Netflix. When you're watching a movie, it has an IMDb rating, which is uniform for all of us. But if you like adventure and I like science fiction, then a science fiction movie will show up as highly relevant for me, not for you. Right? So we have a relevance score, which is again matching with your user profile and your user interactions, and seeing that this company is somewhat more relevant to you than the other one. So this is kind of how it works. You choose the company, then visit the company details. So part of that comes from data sources, automated, part of it is curated. So we have a team which is curating the information. For example, the company description that you get from databases may not be that complicated. How do you make that better? So a team of human analysts curate that information, giving you better quality of insights. Then you can just contact those people through the platform. At the back end, you can integration to connect with those people and then unlock the responses. So it's as simple as that. So revenue model, one, as I mentioned, $200 per quarter subscription. Then when you get responses as part of the base package, you can unlock a number of responses. But if you're getting a lot of responses, that's also a revenue model for us. A success-based fee. Every response that you receive, you have a $5 fee for unlocking that response and opening that email. Right? Third is this custom research added to it. For example, this client from Bangalore who's using the platform also wanted some more details about the company which is not on the platform. So we have been coming from Evaliser, and my co-founder will talk about it. He's also from ex-Evaliser. I am Kevita and Evaliser for 12 years based in Bangalore. Both of us coming from that background, we know how to run a custom research organization. And there's a custom research outfit, service layer on top of the platform. So it's a combination of service and the platform. So that's the three-pronged revenue model we have. Very quickly on the IP that you're building here, of course, a lot of data is getting created. The workflow around it is an IP. And so you can see a lot of different kinds of things. We can talk more in detail, but just in the interest of time, I'm not getting into the details. But a very strong content and workflow IP we are building out here, right? As we build more data. Now, this has an inherent viral tendency. Because if you are reaching out to a company, that person receives the email, many of them might, just like any other cold email, it might go into the spam folder, but some of them will receive it. Some of them will say, okay, it's not interested, delete it. Some may unsubscribe. But some of them might actually check out and say, okay, this is interesting. That's exactly how anything happens, right? Even in LinkedIn, when you start connecting with people or you send the email. So in this case, people will check it out. Also, there is a possibility that some of them will actually start liking the leaders. They will come and subscribe to the leaders. Then they will start sending emails to more people. Right? So that's how, in fact, if you can make the relevance match really work well and don't allow people who do not have a good relevance fit to connect through the platform, then this becomes a relevant inbound email that you get. Right? And then you start signing up with the leaders, and then that's how we get new customers. Reaching out to new customers through our own channels. I mentioned 8.8 million. So again, I can walk you through the details, but I just wanted to quickly show you how that kind of breaks up. So practically, we have an opportunity to achieve about $500,000 in 10 years. Right? It of course depends on a lot of factors and parameters, and this is the practical thing that we have put, but this is achievable. Right? So based on the market that we have, it's global. So this is again, so what we are carving is a niche which does not exist today, but it's at the cusp of, if you call it, companies like CD Insights or Traction, Databox, which are more focused on startup data. And it's also at the cusp of, at the other end, companies like Everstream, Sixth Sense, Lattice Engines, which are more of lead generation tools, right? So this is where we actually play, at a much more affordable rate with high quality insights. Okay, quick look at who we are. Thank you, Vishnu, for the introduction. But my co-founder is Mahesh. He's from he's not here today, right? But he's based in Bangalore. He used to work with me for the past 12 years in fact, in the last organization, in Evalus, the last 3 years, I was with, in the UK creating an internal startup called InsideV. And he was the CEO of that. I was leading that. So we have worked together for all these 12 years, have a very close working relationship. And then we have BIS research. So Ravi here is the director of BIS research. BIS Antushar, who is an ICBN from Delhi, is also the director of BIS research. So it's a 4-year-old company focused on emerging technology research. Right, so it's kind of fits in very well in terms of the whole motive behind it. So the three entities, so between the three founders, called BIS as an entity, it's about 60 lakhs in open assets. Then we have got about 25 lakhs of angel funding after that, and now we are getting into the seed funding round. Quick look at the team right now. So we have 4 full-time members managing technology as well as product and marketing. But at the same time, we also have a 4-5 member team right now, which is a set of interns from Delhi College of Engineering, IIT Kanpur, and a variety of campuses. So that's about 10 people at this point in time based in Gurgaon. This is the BIS research team. Ravi, of course, is here, and Tushar is here. And Faisal is again, Ravi's super junior, and called from IIT Bitsilani. He's the CEO, very entrepreneurial, 28 year old, very entrepreneurial. He's leading BIS research. And Gaurav Gagar was, he was the co-founder of Adda 52, which he exited. And he's also a co-founder of Homestay Credit, which recently got some significant funding. So it's a very entrepreneurial team behind it who has been supporting us as an incubator. So a quick roadmap where we are, where we hope to be. So in 5 years' time, we want to be, having a run rate. So in 2022, we have estimated a $32 million revenue. So a run rate of over $40 million by the end of 2022. 2.5 million users. When I say 2.5 million users, these are not paid users, right? People who subscribe to the platform get a lot of free stuff, but then you have a funnel version of paid users out there, right? So that's kind of the journey. Again, I won't get into all the details in the interest of time, but very happy to talk through that. What we're looking for right now is about 4 crore for a 25% stake. And we believe that this is a great opportunity at this point in time as an investment opportunity. We have put our blood and sweat into it. And I've after 18 years, left my corporate job, right, and really focused on this, right? And so we believe that this is going to work. That's where we are right now. So one slide on the projections that we have here. So we hope to become EBITDA positive by 2020, middle of 2020. And because of the platform play, you would have your EBITDA margins going up after that. So this kind of, we can of course, discuss more details of how the spreadsheets work and all that, but a very high level summary of what we think is practical. So I'll stop here. So we are 6 months old. I came back from the UK in August last year, met Ravi and the BIS team in September, and then we were mulling over a few ideas. In fact, initially we started with something on the banking industry, but then we pivoted that. Finally, we came down to this idea and said, yes, this is the one we wanted to go after in January. And by February, we just, in December, we created the entity called Diligence Infotech Private Limited. By early February, we had the team ready and we started the design and development. So in 6 months' time, we now have the MVP product and a few customers. You can also see a couple of testimonial customers. Candela Labs in Bangalore is a testimonial customer of ours. It's an insurer tech firm who are using our platform. And then there are a few more who are not testimonial customers yet, but we have customers so far. Just launched early July, so within a few weeks, we already have a few customers on the platform. The active marketing is really starting out now. So in August, of course, Western markets are now in the summer break. We are also going slow rather than wasting a lot of money when people are away at the beaches. But by the time they are back, we have a very aggressive campaign in the Western markets. So that's about it, Ravi. Thank you.
So I think thank you, Hiriya Bhai, for giving this opportunity right here. Diligence is an opportunity which we believe, is looking at a 30 million valuation in a period of about 3 to 4 years. And most of the companies with Tushar, me, we have incubated, have hit the numbers which we have looked at. And it's open for people to come and talk about it.
Thank you. temporarily?
So I just saw your presentation. Can you just tell us a breakup? How do you plan to utilize this 41 million? What are you planning to raise? How do you plan to use this 41 million? And this is. And you said that this is till June 2019 because you'll be going for a successive round of funding in June 2019. So how do you intend to use this? And also, you know, who are peer groups right now? Are there anyone in your peer center who are providing similar stuff? If you can just throw some light on that.
Sure. Okay.
Let me tell you, this question is coming from somebody really into this subject.
Yeah, sure.
So you better be accurate. He'll throw more questions on you now.
I'm delighted about it. So, so first of all, so the 44 crore or in USD terms, $600,000, right? Large part of that will go into the technology development. Right now, we are using relatively basic AI models like Word2Vec and stuff like that. But we want to expand a lot more on that and have a very solid AI platform behind it, because that's actually what is going to really drive the growth, right? So AI is going to be an important area where we will put a lot of this money. Second is, at this point in time, we need to get the market access. So we're not planning to have a lot of people on show as salespeople, but we would be spending, we already started, for example, our SEO efforts have already started 3 months back. But there's a lot more. We are doing content marketing. We'll do some PPC, paid campaigns, and SEO. So SEO has already started. So all of that also requires a good amount of firepower, right? So one for technology, expanding the features further, and AI, and second for marketing. That's kind of where the money will be split, right? And I can talk about the exact split and how it behaves and all the other things. Sorry, what was the second question?
The peer group, are there anyone?
Yes, so as you saw in that competition slide, right? If you look at, on the one hand, you have firms like Traction or all these companies, they basically are also, they would look at sales and marketing, B2B sales and marketing or B2B corporate strategy. Put a lot of focus on global companies, especially in emerging markets, and really target the sales and marketing use case with a very simple workflow without signing up for something which is which requires an annual subscription of like $20,000, like CB Insights probably does, right? Or DataFox, which is about $5,000 per annum that you need to subscribe to get this. So there is a global audience, but we want to kind of disrupt that commercial model and make it much more affordable and accessible to small and medium enterprises. Does that answer your question?
Friends, we are open to the Q&A, so if anybody wants to throw more questions on it.
Yes, please.
So, as I understand, so all the companies will have a diligence score, right?
Yes, that's right.
So, how do you choose which company should have the score? Or it's auto-driven, some AI is there,
yes,
which automatically picks up the company, or there's a team of people who chooses the company?
Right. So, as a starting point, we have used databases like Crunchbase. Right. For example, Crunchbase tracks about 500,000 companies. But a lot of information is not up to date, incorrect. Sometimes company descriptions are like a great company down the road from Tampa bus stand. Right? So it's not the kind of description we want to have on our platform. Right? So you need to curate that. So the starting point is databases, which would already have a lot of company lists. But then the problem with most of these is if you look at a Privco or a Crunchbase or any of them, you don't have very good coverage of emerging economies. Right? That's where we select using a variety of lists and then start adding those companies manually. Right? Now, when you say manual, there are two parts to it. Part of the data can come from automatic sources. Right? You have a company description. For example, if you write a crawler which looks at PR newsfire descriptions, you get a good description already onto the platform. But do you want to just copy-paste that? No. That's where we do a bit of curation with human analysts. So it's a combination of automation, combination of selecting from various lists, automated coverage of information. News, of course, you can automate, coming from Bing API and various places. Right? Then you curate the description and other parts using a human hand.
Now I have two more questions.
Yes.
So the first is, how much is man hours is needed in average to get the company profile of one company profile? And the second question is, once the company profile, the score is created, then how often do you go back and look at the financials or the development? Like after 6 months, the Right. Scenario will not be the same for the same company. It may have gone up or down.
Right.
So how often do you have to revisit the same company's growth change?
Sure. So two things, right? For data that comes from databases, you know, the effort is relatively less because you only need to validate this more, right? For example, is the company is selected tally accurate? Is it a, there are things we provide on our platform which won't be there on a Crunchbase, for example, if, even if the base data comes from there, like whether the company is a B2B company or a B2C company, right? Which is something we manually curate. Now, data that comes from these databases, the effort actually is not a lot. A few minutes, like 10 minutes, you can actually curate a lot of things on the company, right? But if you have to create a company from scratch, then the effort goes to 20, 25 minutes to basically get all this data together from automated sources and then ensure that you have a high quality information out there. Right? But good part is once you train, and if you have a good set of people, of full-time employees as well as interns from places like IITs, you actually have a fairly robust team and a quality control process. Sitting in India, you can do a lot better than a Silicon Valley model. Right? And which is what we have done in the past. And we, in InsightBe, which is the previous startup that I kind of incubated within Evaluser, my previous company, was focused on company and sector research. So we kind of understand where the bottlenecks would be, what information is available. Financial data is not available on all companies everywhere, but US and UK companies, companies house and you know the SEC filings, you could actually find a lot of information. But if you're looking at a European company or an African company, you may not get that information that easily. But India you can find from MCA filings, right? So I mean, but not every country, right? So it varies, right? I mean, if you have information and if it's easy to find, then something would be just take just 5 or 7 minutes. Something would also take 20, 25 minutes after the automation part. So we don't curate all companies, right? We want to curate. So diligence, interestingly, diligence is not on diligence. Because we are still on, initial mode and a little bit of angel funding. So we have not featured that because we are not probably the best sales and marketing target that we should waste their time on at this point in time. So once we get there, then hopefully that's good, right? We will also feature our own company. So there's a bit of curation that happens at that level itself, rather than taking a lot of companies out there. Does that answer your question? Thank you.
So Manoj, on the same lines, so would this your tie-ups with credit rating companies help you, or you already in line with that?
No, I think absolutely it would help because especially.
Deepak was trying to ask you about the evaluating the company. So something that the professionals are already doing, will that help, or you already in line with such thought?
So the thing is, in India, for example, you have a lot of credit rating that you can find, right, from various sources, right? So I think again, this varies from country to country, right? There are some things, US, India, there are, again, a lot of credit rating agencies, Moody's, S&P, you can get all of that, right? Public information you can find through internet sources. But if you want something deeper, then we may not probably feature that on the platform. But if somebody wants to get into deeper levels of that kind of information, it becomes a customized offering. Everything you don't have to provide at a $200 subscription on the platform. Okay. That's where you kind of draw the balance.
No, but I think that those companies which are established credit rating companies whom many of the financial institutions vouch for,
yes,
and having a tie-up and they also vouching the same what you're doing will possibly help.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. See, that's the kind of roadmap, right? We now started with this, right? In fact, there are many routes that we can take to overall improve the platform's richness, right? So credit rating is one direction. Whether we want to take it down that path or some other path is a different question.
So Madhusudan,
where am I?
Shown a substantial increase in projecting your registered customer from 19 to 20, 20 to 21, 21 to 22.
Right.
What is the market share that they hold while you are suggesting such kind of increase in the registered customers?
Right. So this market is fairly big, right? For example, like I said, there are 125 million small and mid-sized companies around the world. And what we are talking about is a very small part of that. So if you look at a company like CB Insights, it's 6 years old. They completely focus only on the startups and on investor use case. Still, they have a newsletter and they have a finance subscription, free subscription that's running, which has 300,000 people already on that, right? So when I look at this market share, I think it's a bit undefined at this stage, to be very candid, right? Because this is the kind of opportunity we have out there. And if you really look at B2B sales targeting for non-emerging companies as the area, then we can easily be a 30-40% market share of that point in time, right? But because we are carving a new niche, it's a bit hard. If I just tell you a number, it will be a figment of imagination, really, on the market side, market share part. Because there isn't anyone who is doing it exactly how we are planning to do this. But I'm sure over the next 3 or 4 years, there will be a lot of competition coming here. But because we have an early start in a model like this, we should be able to grab a 30-40% market share.
Manoj, I'm just interrupting between. I welcome Mr. Sunil Alai, who is the chief guest here. So, sir, we are going through this company called Zelligence, who is doing the startup pitch to their newly formed company. So, they had their brief introductions, and then we're just wrapping it up with the Q&A. No. So, we just continue with the Q&A.
Thank you, we are done.
Yeah. Friends, we are open to more Q&A with Mr. Manoj and Ravi. Anybody else? One question from my side, Manoj, that those projections which you showed as paid customers, you had 25 and then 1,000 and all. So how do you derive to that figure? I mean, it's surely assumptions.
Yeah, it's surely assumptions, but it's very conservative. I must say it's 0.25% okay. of the subscriber base that we're talking about here. Assuming that a lot of people will come for free sites, mm-hmm. part of that, so we kind of use, right? How many will actually use it in a quarter? Mm-hmm. People who are registered, everyone will not use it all the time. And how many of them who use it in a quarter will actually become a paid subscriber? And then again, three revenue models. Some of them will actually become customers. Some of them will just go for a subscription for $200. Right. So it's kind of, that's the breakup. And I'm very happy to share all the details. It's a very detailed spreadsheet here. But does that answer your question on market share? It's a bit open, right? I just want to be very candid on that. Right? Because it's no point just giving a number, this is going to be the market share, because it's a very different model that we're trying to make.
Friends, if we have no other questions right away, I mean, offline, of course, Mr. Manoj and Ravi are available, so we can discuss it offline more. So we'd like to proceed. So friends, a big round of applause for Mr. Manoj and Ravi for this talk. Thank you. Friends, quickly, running, we have our another big event called Digital Summit coming up on 10th of August. This is in tie-up with Industrial Technologies, headed by Abhishek Rungta, who is also an ICBN member. Unfortunately, he's not here today, so he's a little tied up. So we have one of his partners, Alkesh Agarwal, who is also an ICBN member. So they'll quickly run through that Digital Summit presentations, and then we'll take it forward for the main event today. So Alkesh, can we please have you?
Good evening, friends. Today I am representing here Abhishek Rungta, who is a fellow ICBN, and he's organizing a big digital summit, Digital Success Summit. And there's a video that I'd like to show, because this summit is this summit will be East India's biggest digital summit. And why it is going to be the biggest is that the kind of speakers Abhishek is calling here in this part of India is, I would say this is the first time the quality of speakers are like such. Not only that, the experts from different domains will be here, so you cannot just, it will not be only listening event, but you can really network with them, speak one-to-one with them, and know more about the digital framework. We all will agree that digital has bring a paradigm shift in the way I think every aspect of our life has been touched by digital. And especially when it comes to business. I think it's high time we all should look forward to different aspects of digital and deploy it to stay in game. Can we play a video?
Today we are going to discuss about what are the topics that we are going to cover. Here you go. How to make your domain name a strategic advantage.
What every CEO needs to know about cloud.
Marketing automation, the secret weapon.
Every business is vulnerable to cyber threat. So what can you do to safeguard yours? Creating trust through personal branding.
How to create viral content.
Marketing KPIs. what matters and what does not. How to do influencer marketing right.
Transforming enterprises through digital innovation.
Streamlining your marketing using smart tools.
Empowering workforce using digital.
IoT and analytics. The perfect combination to optimize your business operations.
Enabling process excellence and control using digital.
And one more thing that I'd like to highlight. The entry fee for this event is 4,000 rupees per participant, but ICPI Abhishek Rukta has made it free for all ICPI members. So please go register and be there. Thank you.
Thank you, Akhish. Friends, it needs special mention here that our ICPI pillars, Alkesh, Abhishek and all have been, this online registration is costing for any participant amount of 4,000 rupees. But for ICPI members, they have been very kind enough to waive off the entire fees for all ICPIs and for members. So this really needs a lot of appreciation. So thank you, Alkesh, thank you, Abhishek. Friends, in order to ask you to upgrade technologies and be ahead of time, this event is being streamed live. So we'll have the links available on our website, and then it will be on YouTube, Facebook, and also this is being live streamed today. Thank you. Thank you, Aditya. Friends, our next big event is with Guruji Shri Gaur Gopal Das on 25th of August at ITC. So we'll of course have all the flyers and the necessary details ready. Once again, it would be just for members without any charges. So that's the next big event that's coming up on 25th of August. And now coming in close as an introduction about ICPI. We would like to play a small video which would be kind of an explanatory video, especially to our chief guests and I welcome his family, legal, financially, and I welcome you. So, we have this small video about ICPI presented, sir, and which would give you a fair idea, Vishalak, and then after that, we'll take it forward.
Servicing can be defined throughout an enterprise. To make your own decision. For your own banks. Both of the stars will be magnified to you. Are you ready to take that risk? You have an idea that the world is just dying to see. A dream that must come true. But then, do you really feel the need to make the most out of your dream? Because I have to stand before the movie and convince them of your certain success. On the brink of the movie, and bring it up to sing. Amen. If you're kind enough to agree, you're a man who is stone of constant change. If you're loving to the eyes of your mad competition, and still three chances no one else can, but enough is never enough. Only then will you succeed. Being the next entrepreneur will cost you a piece of yourself. But it's nothing compared to the sweet taste of victory, the glory, and everything that comes with it. Be the next entrepreneur.
Thank you, friends. Friends, we would like to start the main evening today, the talk show, with an auspicious lamp lighting. So I would request founder, member, trustee Aditya Murarka, Mahesh Kedia, to please join Mr. Alad for the lamp lighting. Sir, please. Friends, with this, I would request ICBN member Rashmi. We've got few lady members as of now amongst our 200 approximately.
I believe that.
Yeah. I couldn't see you, sorry. I would request Rashmi and Vinita both please come and felicitate Mr. Alad with the bouquet and the memento. So we've got two beautiful ladies as members as of now, so.
Babu, side the car.
Yeah, Abhishek. Yeah. Thank you, Rashmi. Thank you, Vinita. Friends, now I'll take a little time introducing, his introduction needs pages and pages and hours, but then I'll try and quickly run him through. Once again, a very good evening and warm welcome to all the distinguished guests, friends and family. I'm founder ICBN Vishnu Zureka, and I would like to start our today's ICBA talk show with Mr. Sunil Arath by warmly welcoming you all. Before I speak about Mr. Alad's magnanimous profile and achievements, I would love to mention a bit about our passion, our ICBI. So we could just explain about ICBI briefly with the video for all the newcomers here. Friends, this idea came up with our day-to-day business lives, what we go through, finding connections, finding references, finding the right platform to share new ideas, finding solutions from government bodies, which gave way to the formation of this chamber, which has now approximately 200 confirmed members in Calcutta and Delhi. So we also recently, last week, we opened our chapter in Delhi also. And with many new chapters coming up, pan-India and overseas. I take pride in quoting Steve Jobs here who said, quote, great things in business are never done by one person. They are done by a team of people, unquote. And I take pride in saying here that with the amazing team of members that we already have, and especially the core group members spearheading respective facets of ICBI, we are moving good, and yes, we are moving strong enough that's making very good noise with ripple effects among decade-old several business chambers in Calcutta. Friends, as Steve Jobs once again said, quote, you have to trust that the gods will somehow connect in your future. You have to trust in something.
your gut, destiny, life, karma, whatever, unquote. And friends, believe me when I say this, that we all members shall cherish our decision to be a part of ICBI, as in the coming years, ICBI is going to be a body to reckon with, and we assure that we shall create history. Let us pledge that we shall not stop until we reach our goal, to let's keep moving forward with connect, trust and growth. Friends, with this about ICBI, I once again welcome this author's learned gathering and will now speak about the man himself. I mean, this is going to be a Herculean task, I know that. So Mr. Alag, of course, we've been known, and I call him at times friend. He said, ki nahi aap mat bula karo, uncle mat bula karo, but you know, so I've addressed him as Mr. Alag here. So Mr. Alag is the founder and chairman of SK Advisors, a business advisory and consultancy service with an emphasis on marketing and brand management strategies. He's a recognized thought provocateur who enables teams to realize their full potential and partners them to build a sustainable, profitable business model. He has a super wide range of clients, almost all the corporate houses and the biggest brands that may come to your mind. A bit about his career history. Mr. Alag has 40 years of hands-on experience and has developed and incubated several successful brands like Britannia Tiger, most of us know. He also spearheaded Britannia's successful foray into dairy through branded cheese and milk. He has a wealth of rich experience in marketing and brand building strategies. Mr. Sunil Alag's rich experience in multiple stakeholder management helps him mentor the topmost executives, flow through business objectives, amidst conflicting personal objectives, fractured governance, and challenging needs for succession planning. Mr. Sunil Alag held very senior positions in the private sector, and of course, I mean, we all know that he was the former managing director and CEO of Britannia Industries Limited. Friends, needs special mention here. This one of my friends highlighted that he joined December 1974, to be precise. And he's seen Britannia grow from an SME to what we know today as a large cap. So, I mean, we were just discussing who better than him to, you know, guideline, you know, help us, you know, inculcate some similar, you know, vision and similar dreams like what he turned Britannia into. So, during his tenure, it needs special mention that Britannia touched significant heights and figured in the Forbes list of 300 best companies in the world in 1999, 2000, and again in 2002. It is during his tenure that Britannia also became the most trusted food brand in India, friends. That needs special applause for him, please. Friends, Mr. Alag is on the boards of various big corporates today, imparting with his experience and knowledge. In addition, he is a senior advisor member of the Prasad Bharati board with the Government of India, and on the executive committee of FICCI. He is also the past president of All India Management Association, Delhi, Bengal Chamber of Commerce, Bangalore Chamber of Commerce and Industry, the Federation of Biscuit Manufacturers of India in Delhi, and he was a member of the Governing Council of the National Institute of Design in Ahmedabad. He is also into the Board of Management of Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, New Delhi, and also in the governing body of IIM Bangalore and IIM Indore. Friends, if you guys are unaware, Mr. Alag is a Calcutta lad, so St. Joseph's schooling, St. Xavier's economic honors, and also an IIM Calcutta graduate. A bit about his personal life. So he's been actively involved with Save the Tiger campaign of Sanctuary Magazine. He's also on the advisory board of the Indian Music Group of St. Xavier's, Bombay, whose major objective is to promote Indian classical music amongst the youth in Mumbai. He is also the anchor of the job show on CNBC, a reality program that ensured entry-level jobs with reputable companies for the youth of India. Mr. Alag has been invited by reputed investment banks on numerous non-league shows in USA, UK, Singapore and Hong Kong to present India as an attractive investment destination for foreign investors. About his awards and recognitions. He's been honored with the Gold Medal Kashalkar Memorial Award 2000 for outstanding contribution to the food processing industry in India. And he was also among the finalists for Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year Award 2002. Friends, believe me, I could go on and on and on, but you're not here to hear me for sure. So you hear it from the tiger's mouth directly. So it was so easy, friends, to, you know, search about him, and but it was so difficult to try and shorten the speech address that I had to do, which was really difficult task. And not taking further time, friends, I called upon the man himself, and let's welcome him with a huge round of applause. Our Calcutta lad.
Like an obituary when he reads something like this. And you know, he's invited me, and I've just got the feeling that you're more interested in digital, which I know very little about. Okay, so all my life, I've always had people who have been digital, but fundamentally, nothing changes on how to get a competitive and a good business going. No matter what you are doing, digital is just a medium that you use today to achieve what we were achieving without it. So it's a new one. We use television, we use cinema, we use media. Now you are digital, which is a double-edged sword. But, you know, I sometimes wonder how people begin and address young people like you who are presumably not on digital, but taking over businesses either as startups or what your father has created. You are from Prakash Roadways, right, Vishnu? So I don't know how to build it up and become the number one transport company in India. You know, but I always say that I'm a Punjabi, born and brought up in Calcutta. But Punjabis, I won't give any thought-provoking speech today, for sure. Punjabis are not for, you know, and leave a thought with them, they keep it, and when you see them again, they give it back to you because they don't know what to do with your thought. They're all action-oriented. Bengal, I worry about, I was brought up here, so when you give a Bengali a thought, you make a philosophy out of it and do nothing after that. But let me just share with you what I have learned from selling consumer products like biscuits and cigarettes and everything else, which has nothing to do with digital. I mean, people will not go on to the digital to buy a biscuit. They will not go on to digital to buy a cigarette. But all the theories that have been attached to it are the fact that, let me tell you a very simple thing, cigarettes lead to cancer. All of digital will show you their needs. So people should stop smoking. Why don't they stop smoking? So my job is to understand that rather than work on digital alone. Why does a person eat biscuits? Why does a person give up biscuits? And the whole lot that we go along. But I will then start and I will share with you. I mean, I prefer Q&A all the time, you know, in any case. Now, boss, I'm technically challenged. So somebody is going to tell me, what do I press first, follow the slide from there?
No, let me do it from here, it's so much easier, yeah.
I'll see what's going on. I like a Q&A session rather than, I'll finish speaking in about 10 or 15 minutes, and then you're free to ask me any question on what I put up or what I haven't put up for you. Because these are learnings from? Yeah. From, is there any learnings which I have picked up I could carry on in life? Because I think I'm perhaps the only person who's been sacked twice from the same company and returned. So I've learned a lot in my life in terms of what learnings are. And I think I'll just go to the next slide, which is, see, one thing that very few people I find, not you all, I'm not referring to you all, who have got a vision first about what they want to do in their lives and what do they want to do with their companies. Today, everybody is in for instant gratification. I've started something, in 5 years I want to sell it, I want to make money. Nobody's got any long-term vision of any organization that they want to build on. And Arya, very good Arya. See, but this is what Helen Keller said.
Okay, great, wonderful.
Very good, you can ask. Just read this, huh? And she's a blind lady. All of us have sight but no vision. You know, we can see things, we are doing things, but what is the real vision that you are getting into becomes very important to you. Okay, and then I'm going to give you a few things that I've learned on this. See, as a Punjabi, you must simplify. We are champions at bureaucracy,
You give them a problem, they'll complicate it for you by putting 20 clauses to it. Whereas if you want to actually come to a solution, which I have learned with my team when I was in Britannia and everywhere else, I said, don't walk into my room with more than two options. I can say yes to one or no, but if you come with 15 options, I don't need you because you're giving me a headache. So if you don't simplify and distill your problem, that problem, as far as I'm concerned, is a constant. You are the variable. You think the problem is big because you don't know what the solution is. You think the problem is small because you know the solution. So what is the variable in the system is you. The problem is constant. So that's one thing that you learn to simplify first is the max of vision. So what I did was that if you take a look at, I'll give you one ad here to demonstrate how a simple vision of a company is actually, these ads are not, don't worry about the ad is to drive home a point. So, I mean, how will I run the ad twice? Now it's come here, so what? Oops. Yeah. And that's the ad, and it said that if I click twice. Okay, then tell me about the ad. And I'm not going to tell you about the ad, you just see it, you realize what that company is all about.
What is this about big? You know, seeing the big picture, having the big idea, clinching the big deal. Nobody wants to clinch the middle deal. Who wants to do that? Be a little deal clincher, the small shop. When you go get a burger, you want a big bag. You go to the front there, you ride Big Dipper, you turn on TV and you see Big Bird, or you're afraid of the big bad wolf. When I was growing up, I wanted to be the big man. I never wanted to be the little man. Even the little man wanted to be the big man. You go to America, you want to go to the big apple, not the little apple. I get up in the morning, I want a big breakfast. I want my girlfriend to say, good morning, big boy. To which I reply, I've got a big day today. Been meeting with big cheese from a big studio. It's a big time with big bucks. And she looks at me, rolling her big blue eyes and saying, big head. I retort, what's the big deal? Give her a big kiss. I get my big car, sit out in the big wide world. She gives me a big wave, close the door of our big house. Look in the mirror and ask herself, does my bum look big? In my big meeting, I turn to one of the big hitters and I say, I love this movie, it's going to be big. There's only one small problem, my fee. I'd like to be, what's the word?
See, perfect clarity on the vision. You cannot get away, they want to be a big bang. They don't care about profits. They don't care about anything. Of course, they don't make a loss. But this is the way you have to keep on hammering your idea to everyone. Okay? So I was quite inspired by watching. This is a very old ad, by the way now. So, but I then called my team in 1993 and I said that let's write a vision statement for Britannia. And I then looked at all the vision statements available, whether it's Procter & Gamble, anybody, all of them said you're going to be a responsible shareholder, make profits, look after your people, but different words. So nobody really owned any vision statement or for their own company, which was so particular to them that that's what they wanted. So I sat down with my team for one full day. I said, what do we want to be in the next 5 years, 10 years, 20 years? Decide that. So then they came up. In 2004, it was every third Indian should be a Britannia consumer. Why did we say third? We said third Indian because at that time, there was about, I think our population was around 900 million. 300 million could afford our products. 600 was part of the government's responsibility. They were below the poverty line. They couldn't buy a packaged product. So I said, if we are looking at 300 million, that is what my target is to start with. And then as we go along, it becomes every second Indian, it becomes the first Indian. For 15, 20 years, you don't have to change your vision. because that's all you want to do if you want to remain in India. So start writing a vision which you think can be achieved first and becomes very important. Now, how did we deliver the new idea? From there came eat healthy, think better. We were first, Britannia biscuits are the best, okay, maybe anybody else can also say we are better. But the whole line that we developed from this was Britannia, eat healthy and think better. So there we went on. And I said, how do you describe when you eat healthy and think better? Because it's very difficult to say it in words. There were a number of ads that we ran. Not a single word was spoken. But I'll run another one just now for you to just show you. And I tell you, when it started, there were kids who stood up and applauded in halls and schools. And all mothers also took to this ad, and we said nothing about it. Can you run the second ad, please? Just say swasth khao tan man jagao, which was eat healthy and think better translated. We had a number of, this kid did about 5 or 6 ads. He was playing football on his own, he was playing tennis, he was playing every single game all by himself, imagining that he was a McEnroe or someone else, and all the mothers wanted their child to be like that. All the kids wanted to be like that. It worked wonders. I mean, it sometimes works. But let me run through another one. Read this. This is perhaps the best vision statement I've had in a long, long time. I will tell you in a moment. Is there any doubt if you are working for FedEx what you are supposed to do? For every employee, once you've read this, the vision. Prakash Roadways should be having this kind of a vision. Because ultimately, at the end of the day, they said, if you're not, you're out. Everything that you have to do is all outlined here. From the lowest worker to the MD, everyone understands that vision. Every third Indian becomes a Britannia consumer. If you went and asked the guy who was loading it onto the, he asked him, that's the way a vision goes. If only the top guys understand the vision and nobody else in your team, it's your issue, forget about anything else. So much easier to do it. The second thing that I've learned is, where are we going now? Potential is what you can do and not what you produce. Now that this is, I think, for digital guys, when you say, I was producing biscuits, but was that the potential of Britannia? You're doing something, is that your potential? So you have to move beyond that. You have to never leave resources unutilized in your system, whether they are people, whether it's money, anything at all. In fact, I'm reminded of a story because with so many breaks, I might as well tell you one more interesting story so you wake up. Talking about not leaving any resources unutilized, a lady goes out and there's a guy staying at home by himself, and there's a door, the bell rings, and there's this gorgeous looking woman, but dirty jeans, torn t-shirt, everything. She says, can you help me? So he said, well, I mean, there was a sandwich I haven't eaten for so many years, or so many days, and there was a sandwich which was nearly expiry date, so he went, opened the fridge and gave it to her, so she ate it. And then she said, well, can I quickly have a bath? And there were jeans which he told his wife, you know. And of course, he was in a compromising position when his wife walked in, and his wife was walking out. So he was explaining to his wife what had happened. So he said, your jeans were there, you thought you'd get fit. Not, so I gave it to her. There was a clean t-shirt that had been lying for a couple of years. And then she was very happy and she was going. And then she turned around, is there anything else that your wife hasn't used for a long time? So So never have unutilized resources lying around, because that is perhaps, at least what you allow, if nothing else. And it's very, very important that we always constantly use and apply your mind. And that's what made me go into dairy, it made me go into cheese, it made me go into various things, because biscuits was not it. You could never get into every home with biscuits. You were not an ITC, you could sold a matchbox and perhaps have the best distribution reach in India. So they had cigarettes, they had panwala shops, holes in the wall, which we didn't have at all. And that prompted me to launch the 1 rupee pack. We were the first, in Chick Shampoo was the first, but we were the first 1 rupee pack of Tiger, which are 3 biscuits, which even a panwala could keep. So look around, there are enough people, as I say, I used to have half an hour session with the team. Please tell me what is the most successful thing that you witnessed in the last 3 or 4 months, and what is the biggest failure? It doesn't have to do with biscuits. We used to spend and we see whether we can apply that to us or not. There are people out there thinking for you, and you don't have to do it yourself. This concept of I will create, I will do everything myself. Yes, there are a few people, you can get a shaving. Wilkinson was the first, that kind of thing. Apple was when they started off. So those kind of innovations take place, but otherwise, supplementary innovations is what you do. How do you take those additional innovations from these big ideas and take over from anyone else? And that, I think, according to me, brings me to my next slide. What do I mean when I say I've learned beg, borrow, and steal? This is something which nobody wants to do. But for me, when I say beg, it means you beg the people around you to stay with you. When I say you don't fall on your knees, but if you've got good people, they may not want only money, they might want X amount. So you make sure and you beg them to stay with you, because if they leave you, you're going to do a lot on your own. And it's very, very important that you continue this. I have to beg my wife to be with me for 40 years also. She's going to argue. What the hell? If you really love her, you're going to beg her to stay. So relationships, work, everything, you have to beg. Borrow is what I said earlier. You can't do everything yourself. Today you have a specialist who's a security guy. You're not going to put it up. You cannot, you're not running a shop anymore. You can sit in a Kakeda hotel and he buys also himself. He sells, he cooks, everything. Maybe that's the way you start. But ultimately you have to start borrowing expertise at a lower cost to you, which led to contract packing for Britannia. When you make Tiger and with our overheads, if we made it, we'll never make money. But there were so many people available who had the money but didn't have the marketing to put the brand out. They produced it for you cheaper. So always borrow. And steal, I don't mean an idea, because then you would go to jail. But you have to steal an idea and make it bigger. Now you take, for instance, who should have created the iPod? Should have been Sony. Sony is the one who started the Walkman. It had one slide with music on the go. They went to sleep. Here you come. Now this guy puts up, you can have 100 songs. At that time, and Walkman was the first thing. You didn't have to carry the big system around. And yet, they lost out because they slept on it. So, and this is where you sewn in the idea and made it so much bigger, because digital arrived and everybody arrived and they've gone on. But think back. Now, at this point of time, that is what is the most important thing that we have to think about. And I'm not going to carry on, because you can ask me any questions after we finish. And this is where we beg the best to join you. You beg the best to join you. You borrow what you can't make competitively, outsource, see if you can get better ideas, steal it, own it, make it also. That's the most important thing in life. Now, that's what I learned, and then we come. This is a typical, you read the commandments, it says, you must do everything to others and whatever else, what you want, but thou shalt do unto others what you do not want done unto you. Now, what do I mean? I want a market share. I want a brand. So you better do something to that guy before he does it to you. So you want to attack the guy before he attacks you. And I've reversed it around from the commandments to say, this is it. Otherwise, if you wait, this is what happened to Walkman, somebody will come in, gone. And therefore, you must do unto others what you do not want done unto yourself. Otherwise, there are very simple little lines which you try and keep in mind, whether no matter what business you're running, and apply this in life, and you will find that this is it. Fair and lovely, if you take a look at Imami. Leavers were sitting on, only women want to be fair. Imami arrived and says, hello, I mean, a lot of men in the south are rubbing their face with powder and looking so excited and everything else. Why are we not addressing them? So simple things like this, actually leavers should have thought. That look, I'm only selling to women fair and lovely, why don't I also get the men? I can't call it fair and lovely, I'll call it something else. But they didn't do it. And therefore that's very important that we take that into account also. Can I have the next slide, please? Yeah, it's gone. Now what you take away from others can be taken away from you. But what you create, you can't. Now you can take away market share by reducing your price. That's, you got it away. But somebody else will come along and reduce the price lower than yours and he'll take it away. So always create something that is yours. Now you take a look at what, when I grew up, what was the hi-fi or the music system that everybody thought of was Philips. It was the number one music system, I mean, that was produced in the world. Then along came Japan, Sony and everybody else said, we'll make it cheaper. They did. They went off to sleep, then along came the Koreans, and now the Chinese with higher. So everywhere, if you are only working on price, somebody will come up with a similar product with a lower price than you. But if you created something like Steve Jobs has done or whatever else, then you own that. And that's difficult to knock out. So always keep that in mind, and then we will see what happens after that. Always be your best challenger. Now this one, I mean, it's a long story for me, so there's, you know, what is a challenger brand? What do you mean by a challenger brand? Because all my life I was the number one brand in Britannia. When I left and I was consulting and I suddenly saw that I had to meet people who were not the number one brand. They were challenging a number one brand. So what does a challenger have to do to take on a big fight with one of the bigger brands? And every day I learn, that's another thing that you have to keep open, is that you think you know everything, you don't. So, and I don't know everything, so today I learn digital from you, but at this point of time, you must always think that you don't know everything. See, L'Oreal are leaders and are constantly innovating. You know, they don't let anybody take it. But, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you have to embrace, I've written it down, complexity and change. Now, what do you mean by complexity and change? You have to be aware. Your awareness of the digital population or platform is very important. You as a CEO or a head, you don't have to do a damn thing. You can hire a digital guy to do it for you. Remember that. They are just there to service somebody who is looking after the customer. And if you treat all digital experts, what does Infosys do? What does Wipro do? They don't have any business of their own. They are only supplying to people who are using them for their own business. Just think of it as to what are they doing. I'm not decrying any digital platform that anyone is creating, but you create a platform for a manufacturer to sell to someone. Remember that in digital you don't own anything, but you're the brains. I'm zero in finance, I'll get the best finance guy. I'm zero in marketing, I'll buy the best marketing guy well. But do not think that you can get away with everything. And you have to recalibrate your brand. I've learned one thing in life is that, it's a long story, but I have an LSE story, which is my own model, which after I became a consultant. And LSE was a drug during college days that you took to get on a high, right? But today, I mean, if you look at LSE, L stands for luxury. And there's a new element which has entered everybody's life, is S stands for stress. And D stands for daily needs. No matter what product you've got, you tell me, I'll fit you into one of these. And how did I learn this was, I was in Venice with my wife on a holiday. And Thomas Cook, before I left, said, this is a bad year. It was, I think, when did we have 2006 or something, 2006 or something, when nobody wanted to travel, they were all saving money, we'll spend next year or whatever. And yet I saw, Thomas Cook was very worried, and yet I saw one boat of all young, from Nasik and everywhere else, and they were all stepping out from the Venetian boats, run by one tour company, which I forget the name, it was some Kasturi Travels. So that guy who was waving the flag, I had to chat with him, how your business is booming. I said, booming? I've just heard in my mind, Thomas Cook said that it's not. Thomas Cook had positioned their product as a luxury. This guy had gone to all the shopkeepers and the small guys and said, I will give you stress relief if you come with me. So he had positioned foreign travel, the same product, as a stress buster, and Thomas Cook had presented it as a luxury. So luxury failed and stress came. It's very, very important that I also advise a tea company, and it's doing extremely well today, only in Maharashtra, it's the number one brand. I said, observe the people. Why do you drink tea? I'm not talking about the very queen type of people who have it in cups and saucers and everything else, but when you're alone, you'll slur. Even if you're the poorest guy and you go to a village, for that 15 minutes he's drinking his cup of tea and he's lost to the world. All his problems are over. Watch that guy and then you will learn that slurping is very important in India. You know, although it may not be, I slurp when I'm alone, but when I have a guest, I won't do it because it's ill-mannered. So we said, and then all the people who are any tea buyers here, you'll find that they slurp the tea and then they buy it. They throw it out, but catch the flavors and the price goes up or down based on that. So technically, that's the way it's bought. So the line that we chose was, Parivar was the brand, it's called Parivar Chai, Sur Sindhi. And it became the number one brand because everybody said, oh my God, here's somebody who legitimizes the way I want to drink. So it's important always to take a look at what you are doing in life. And of course, you have to be the digital disruptor. Now, what I term as digital disruptor is either adjacent or is direct. Now, for me, adjacent is a lot easier. You have people who are trying, the phone is there. One guy saw everybody running around, so he came up with this thing, no? He came up with a little strap around, fix it to your phone, it'll tell you how many steps you've taken, go back. That's adjacent disruption. You're selling a product, you've forgotten, somebody else comes and uses your product adjacently, never leave it blank. Because he's observed and he's done whatever there is. So, direct is what Tesco has done in Japan. Japan, with Tesco, is what they say, Japanese don't have too much time, they are very small homes. On their tube stations, platform stations, Tesco has put up a huge thing like this. You go there with your phone, you pick what you want, punch your money in, by the time you reach home, it's delivered. So that is doing direct disruption on delivery in a situation where it's not done in London because I don't know why, but Japan, it's a big hit. So that kind of disruption in mall shopping for foods, not easy, but that kind of disruption can also take place. Yeah, can I? Oh, this one I love. This is something from, not that, yeah, where is it? Never been. No, not mine. Yeah, but this is not the slide I wanted, yeah. Ah, that's right, what is this? Yeah. I've already finished this, and let's get on to the next one. So now what I mean by saying you have to think value before you think price. We were all in ads. Huh? Today you have viral stuff which goes on YouTube and all that. This is a very old product for many years. And if you can run the ad on rice, please.
Rice.
Marks you In a crowded market, how to be different? That becomes very important. Yeah. Now this one, what do I mean by it? Everybody loves getting into diversification, get into a business, no plan B. What happens if you fail? What do you do? Abhimanyu was a great warrior, he went into the Chakravyuh, he killed a lot of guys, but he died. You want to be able to come out and still live, right? Even though Abhimanyu will be remembered, you will always be remembered, what a great guy he was, you know, and he fought so well, but he's dead. You have to have a plan, hopefully. When you get into a Chakravyuh, which is a crowded market, always have a plan B which pull out. Don't say that, oh, I've gone in, now what do I do? Stop the bleeding. I learnt it from my wife, who's a doctor, the first thing, and there's a Dr. Kapoor here also. Even if you cut your finger and you want to go for a heart operation, they will have to stop that bleeding first. If you don't stop that bleeding, they won't even do your heart operation. So remember one thing in life, that it is important for all the small things which bleed. I've made mistakes. These are all my learnings from mistakes. Somebody will come and tell you, oh, your product is not working, sir, because let's add some more salt. Oh, it's not working because the packaging is better. Oh, it's not working because the dealers are not doing X. And you also continue with that bleeding for about 18 months because you're emotionally attached to your decision. Instead of in 3 months, if you cut short and say, okay, let's move to the new product, so much better. So that's the job that we do as consultants when we talk to young. We go in and say, what are you wasting your time for? Okay, you made a loss of 1 crore, cut your losses. Let's get on to something else. Do not let your team take 18 months to discover later, when which time you've lost about 20 CR already. But we've made all those mistakes, so it's important that we keep that. Somebody has said team is important. I'll show you one ad, which is, I don't have to speak about this, why team becomes important. If you think you can do everything on your own, just watch this one. I'll tell you which ad is this. This is the Mill Valley. Mill Valley. Some ads are, I don't have to speak about them. They'll tell you why a team is important. I'm leading, you know, and everybody comes under your shadow. Today I was, last week I was talking to Harsh Gohinka when he wrote about your shadow should not be so large that everybody is following you, also get into your, they can give you shade and stops you from thinking. I said a good leader will say, no, you create your own shadow, you know, and go ahead. But a team is very important. Now the last slide I'm going to run, because I think you're not going to get very bored. I'll get into the Q&A and I've got some of your questions or whatever. I call it luck, you can call it fate, you can call it God, you can call it whatever you want. And if you don't have that on your side, you can be the brainiest guy in the world, you can be doing every possible thing that you can. I have yet to find success without this. It is the most important thing in life, is that do not think that there is no luck involved. I just, because I'm working hard, everything has to happen. So can I have the last ad, please, which explains this, which is, yeah.
$5. Fries, $2. Urinating in public, $150. Urinating on a police officer, $750. A really good lawyer, expensive. Finding your long lost father, priceless. There are some things money can't buy.
But it says it all. This is it. This is love. And it's very, very important to have love on your side. In whatever you do, don't think you're God, don't think you're anything else. There is a lot of luck involved. Sometimes you will see competition making mistakes and you wonder why they are making mistakes, because you got the luck. You got it on your side. I've learned one more line: when competition is committing suicide, don't step in the way. We always tend to get into an area, oh, that guy is dying, let me also do something. No, no, let him die first, then move in. And always never ever get into, so I can carry on about my learnings in life, and you know, which has been all along. And you talk about marketing, digital, how do you build a brand? You know, when I was doing my IIM in Calcutta, we were just taught that you have to be consumer. Consumer satisfaction was the word for your marketing thing. If you do consumer satisfaction, you're in. 10 years later, it became, I think, consumer, whatever, I think not only satisfaction, what is the English word for it beyond that? So now only you're left with consumer orgasm. There's nothing else left. I mean, but it still is satisfaction. So, you know, you can keep on redoing things, and that's how they do consulting. They come up with even better words, but it is still meaning the same thing. If you are unable to understand the needs of your consumer, if you are unable to innovate on pricing, on packaging, on taking a particular niche and owning it, and I'm not talking about the great innovators, huh? Because there are a lot of people who say, I've discovered something, and a lot of youngsters are coming to me, oh, I've got a great digital product, I've got great X, I've got great Y, but I have a chat with them and I said, and what they lack is funding. Obviously, all of them say, no, there are only three of us or something. 1 out of 100 make it, and because they've got such a terrific product. But the rest of them, I said, have you identified your consumer? Yes, sir, we've had it. Have you identified which big company will want to back you? But they're just going into the market, you know, and just doing it. So it's very important that I question, do you know that there is already 7 products in the market like this? Have you looked at it? You're just one step ahead, but let's find out what you're one step ahead on and then move it. So I want to really ask all you digital guys, have you all come up with a product which is truly innovative? Which is truly something that you feel you own, which cannot be copied? Which is truly not available anywhere in the world? Then you've got a good chance. Viral marketing? What is viral marketing today, if you ask me? It's the same as that old ad of how to make a rice. You don't have good content. It can be vulgar, it can be humorous, it can be anything you like. How will it go viral? Or I've come to humko jara ek viral ad bana dijiye. Are viral ad bana dijiye matlab kya? You cannot create a viral ad unless you understood your consumer fully. Then you try, and then you get on to various ads. So whether it's digital, whether it's old school, whether it's new school, you have to remember that look, you cannot, the fundamentals of life don't change. Fundamentals in marketing never changes. And you can come on and say, well, okay, like think of when television started, that's the end of cinema, everybody is watching everything at home. Has cinema died? Now TV and cinema is sustainable and they're both running along together. Digital has arrived, so you won't do any press advertising, oh, everything, 4 lakh consumers I can get. Very good. You run it on YouTube, but it's a double-edged sword. You make one mistake and you're dead in digital marketing. Because I remember there was one thread found in one of our biscuits many years ago. Today, if they find it, the whole world will know in 5 minutes that you did Britannia biscuit mat khao. So it's very, very important on how you use digital. And when you get into the digital space, you have to be very clear in your mind on how you respond to some. What happened to Maggie? You lost 50% of its sale because it took 3 days to respond, to say anything. And in 3 days, every consumer thought that these guys are lying. They don't know what they're talking about. It's taken them 2 years, a lot of spending. So use digital marketing, but have a plan ready. Should anybody put up something wrong against your product, correct it within 60 seconds. Otherwise, if you're doing well, great. And today I was talking to my daughter. She says there are many things where a bad ad goes viral. Trump is bad, but he's viral. You want to be like Trump? Be like Trump. But so content is important in areas which you consume into your body. In fashion, you can be as bad or good and you can go viral. But can you imagine in food which the mother is giving to the child or you're putting into your stomach and then you say, no, it doesn't matter? It does. There was a milk in Japan which nobody consumes anymore. So it's a question of what kind of product you have before you use digital and how to use digital. Do not get carried away. I always tell everybody that digital is it. It took 10 years for me to even put a website up for Britannia. When web were like, how come Britannia is not on the website? I said, what the hell? Why should I be on the web? Is anybody going and inquiring? What are you buying in your biscuits? I'm part of a group called the YPO Gold. It's Young Presidents Organization. We were known as World President, but now they've changed it for us to feel younger. It's YPO Gold. We had the comedy guys, who are the roast guys, those two guys, just last week, which I attended. And our new president has created an app for the entire group, for our group, a new president of YPO Gold. 100 members, those guys laughed. You need an app for 100 people, you must be wrong. Because he was using something to us and we all clapped and we applauded him. And who's going to look at that app? You know, from our side. So it's very important that you get down to how did they think they are good at comedy? How stand-up comedy come up in the world? And I've understood from them because they were saying, look, we thought having a room of 100 people and laughing was good enough. Suddenly they did this one roast thing where, of course, everybody said should not be done, bad, and Shiv Sena came along, and although Karan and Ranveer Singh were enjoying themselves. They had 4 lakh views. When they saw that, they said, my God, if in Tube I can go to 4 lakh customers, why should I worry now? You know, and of course there were FIRs filed against them and the whole lot, so that was good advertising. More and more youngsters wanted to see what these guys are doing. Happens in comedy, doesn't happen in food. Just remember that much. Doesn't happen. Take your product, take a look and see what you are doing before you get down to doing anything at all. But that's about it. And then let's do a Q&A. I'm ready to answer whatever you want to. These are just some of the learnings that I've got. There are millions, I mean, as you go along. The more mistakes you make, the better off you are. You learn a lot more, always. And you don't have to make all the mistakes in the world, because there are many people around you making them. And are you observing why they're making them? You don't have to do it all yourself. And learn from those mistakes, see if you can make it bigger. That's about it. Thank you so much.
Friends, let's have a huge round of applause for him. That LSD was really learning, and apart from everything, my friend Aditya, he was just joking that if the lady luck doesn't work, so keep changing the lady.
You know, yes, we are talking about keep changing the lady. I think it's an internet joke or something like that. There's an internet joke in the background, which I'm just taking right now. Is this on?
So it's, is it, can you hear me? Okay, fine. This guy has now become very rich. He's driving a fantastic car. He's living in the biggest flat. And he says that, you know, I've now got everything in the world except I have a 50-year-old woman to sleep with. That's his wife. So his wife said, great, wonderful, go and get yourself a 25-year-old girl. Go back to that one-bedroom flat, take a bus, take a train, and then talk to me. That's what you were. So that's very important in life, that you know, when you talk about changing your, they are the ones who stand with you, and I'm all for women. And that's why I was saying that's the best thing that I've learned. Yeah, thank you.
Friend, to take this forward, we'll have not exactly an interview mode, but more like a Q&A moderation session by our very own ICBN Vivek Bajaj. So, friends, he's a co-founder of a Stock Edge app, so which we all call ourselves as the owner as of it as well, which is doing fairly well, and my best wishes for him. So, friends, we have Vivek Bajaj here. So, who would be moderating the question answer round? We'll start off with his few questions that we've already kind of present or already formed. So, with those questions, and then we take it forward. So, now the moderation, Vivek, please.
For your almost 24 credit course. Just give you a brief demographic background.
Yeah, hello.
Yeah. So just give you a brief demographic background of the audience which is here. So largely we all are MSME. Quite a lot of us would be family owned entities. And quite a lot of us would be B2B. So a lot of my questions, it is very difficult to kind of summarize the kind of questions people would be willing to ask. But let me just try to put some questions which may be relevant for a lot of people, and then we will take queries from them also on selected basis. Now, I want to start with digital. Don't mind if I do that. Yeah? Because, okay. And you are there on Twitter, and I saw today's post complimenting Kiran Mazumdar Shah. And I know that how much emphasis you are giving on your digital image. Now, from an organization perspective, whether entrepreneur should be there in forefront in as far as image building is concerned, or the company should be in forefront on the image building part, or if you believe that no, first an entrepreneur should be there and the company should follow, what should be the right timeline for that?
See, this is a tough question to answer directly because you've got some who have been successful. See, Anand Mahindra, for instance, was never in front. His company moved because he went to Harvard and wanted to do filmmaking and all. Now he's come in front. So, but if you have a name like Birla, Aditya Birla's son, the Birla is carrying it forward. Kumara Mangalam has succeeded only now. So if you take the individuals that are succeeding, they are because their fathers have already built the company that they want. But if you're starting something on your own, and if you are willing to put your name up there, and if it fails, they're going to turn around and say, "Isko mat chuna." He has failed. So you always try and put your name second on a successful product. I do it with tea, I do it with, it's, as I keep on telling everybody, do not think digital is taking over marketing. It's fundamental, and therefore, whenever I go to a client, we launch three products. And then we say, all right, we'll try all three. The one that succeeds is one that will carry the company name. If you're brand new, if you're already there, then you have to make up your own mind on what you want to do. So, two fail, one succeeds, then attach your name to that successful product. Then after success, you can fail. But if you fail in the beginning, you've got a major problem. You don't attach your, I would, this is my advice, but you guys are young enough to take all the risks that you want to take in your life, but I wouldn't do it.
Okay. As far as B2B business is concerned, how much value you would give to building a brand around a B2B business?
See, building a brand is important whether you're doing B2B or B2C, because without a brand, you're nothing, as far as I'm concerned. Because there are so many million definitions of brands today that it can confuse anybody. Okay? You get about, you go to Google, you'll get at least 100, if not minimum, in my definition of a brand. But if you're doing B2B, I mean, it all depends upon whether there are, if you assume that I'm the only supplier, very good, you got a monopoly, then you don't have to worry about anything. But competition is going to move in and they are going to underprice you first. You don't have to reduce your price. What is your niche? For instance, if your service is perfect, now for the other guy to perfect his service to your level is that much tougher. And all purchase heads of all the large corporations prefer that if you say, I will deliver this bottle at 9 a.m. on this day, it is delivered. As opposed to, nahi saab, wo lorry, sorry, your Prakash road, wo phas gaya, wahan pe ye ho gaya. So find yourself a niche in B2B. That is extremely important. If you're just saying, okay, I'm one more company in the system, then you're constantly fighting on price. And therefore, you don't own anything. And it'll be taken away from you in no time. So it's important that you find your niche and then use a lower cost advantage. B2B, remember one thing is that you cannot be the most expensive product ever. You may start a great service because assume the other guy will also come up with the service, then you'll have to match his price. So you have to constantly look at your business. How do I keep lowering my cost? And yet I have 2 years off or 3 years off a niche which I will build my brand.
Great. Distribution network, coming back to B2C, because that's where you have really worked in the last so many years. Last 4-5 years, we have seen onboarding of strong distribution network in digital front, be it e-commerce or having your own website for e-commerce activities. From a company perspective like us, who have product now, should we think of putting our mind in developing a physical network now? Because already companies are there who have strong network. Or should we just say that, oh, hey, someone has already done it digitally, why don't we just use that network and focus more on product development?
If you don't have any money and you're starting up, nothing like a digital platform to start on, because it's the lowest cost. But as far as I'm concerned, can anyone tell me how much of business is done digitally in India? India only. 7%. 93% is done outside the digital market. Do not get, I'm not anti-digital, use it when you don't have money. But there are products which are only 7, and how long will it take? See, do you use digital to go and buy a biscuit? No. Do you use digital to go and buy a Baba Ramdev ghee? No. I mean, where are we talking about for a, until we don't reach that area? But we are working women who will say, okay, I mean, I want to buy a cheap bag, I want to buy a cheap brand of lipstick and all, you order it, it comes. Television comes to your house because they're all doing it. So, it's your product that is important on how you use digitally rather than going blindly into digital. You know, there are 900 million, phone users in India out of 1.35 billion. So, it's a very high percentage. But only 300 million have smartphones, huh? The rest of them, 600 million, are just to talk and hi, how are you? But it will not take a very long time for them to convert because the smartphones are becoming cheaper. And therefore, I would say enter digital for certain products, get your presence right. But you don't have to focus unless your product is geared for digital. That's the most important thing. Fashion is, and even fashion, you will not buy a Louis Vuitton bag on with the ladies. Would you buy it on digital, or do you want to feel it? Do you want to go and see it in the market? So that's very important. Cheap products, inexpensive products. Your what is that watch called, or Titan or something? It is Fast Track. Hello, yaar. You know, my father and me, we bought a Rolex watch that remained with us for years. Today you look at the kid, he buys a watch for 500 bucks, throws it away after 6 months, naya design again. Now that's very good to buy on the digital. Because he's not taking a risk, he doesn't like it, he sends it back. But will you buy a Rolex digitally? No chance. You'll still want to go to a shop, take your stuff and go. So I think it's working at a level where the middle income group and lower income group, non-working people, I mean working people and the kids are finding it, let's get home. And that is why I think IKEA will work. You know, IKEA relies on that. But I'll tell you one thing about IKEA. I think my brother-in-law is here, my nephew's in London. He ordered something in London. It took him 12 hours on a Sunday to fix it. Huh? So you better be used to all that. IKEA will, you'll go there, you'll order it. It's inexpensive. It'll come in little pieces. So it's a lot dependent on who's ordering, what kind of product, use it intelligently today, but it won't be long before 10 years, 15 years max, when it'll be quite a thing. But you know, I found when malls came up, and sorry, I'm just telling you this story, they thought, oh God, we now had it. All the retailers went against, they went against Walmart, they're killing us, hum log mar jayenge ye. You know, other than cornflakes, when it was launched, where 50% went and bought it in malls because it was something which you never understood, the Indian consumer. How much, you know, how much a distributor in India charges as a margin? About 7%, 6 to 7. In that 7%, he supplies to rural, everywhere, and he only keeps 2% for himself. You match it in that cost. Now, everywhere in the world, Nabisco biscuits, they're all going back to what we have to have the other guys in. Because when the mall becomes big, or a chain becomes big, he says, I won't keep your product. That's the end of your distribution. Unless you give me this margin. So, I mean, I think I always tell all the younger generation, take a look. You don't have the money, use it, because that's the best way. A lot of people don't have money, just go to Big Bazaar and put your product there. Spend your money in that. Wahan se shuru karo. But it's a starting point, it's not the end. That's what I'm trying to tell everybody, is that value what you have. It's not the end of the world, as yet. Hopefully I'll live long enough to keep saying it, but who knows.
One question with respect to a classic family-owned business enterprise. And I would like to believe that when you joined Britannia, it was kind of a family-owned enterprise. And you have seen the transition of Britannia from a family-owned to a professional organization. And quite a lot of us are from that background. Any input would you like to give to us? How do you move to that?
It's actually reverse, because it was first an English company in Calcutta. It began on Taratala Road. And it was part of what we call the Associated Biscuit Company, which was Peakfreens, Cream, and Jacobs, and one third company come to my name. Those three were the owners, and the Brits used to look at it, and we were running it as professionals, and all they used to come to India, go and see the Taj Mahal, everything is okay, move on. That was the way the British ran Britannia. Then it got bought over by KKR, when Henry Kravis and all outbid our man who was Barbarians at the gate, Ross Johnson. And the American style of working was so different, because we were still professional, and they would come in, okay, what do you think? You think it's great? Do it. You want 10 million? Done. 1 million? Done. But they wanted the results. Unless you are able to prove to your team that you are worthy of that position. And that very rarely is, you know, and then I mentor a lot of families. There's a battle between the son and the father. Battle means not a mental battle. The younger son wants to spend all the money, do it. Come on, we are going to go digital. We got it. Old man is saying, come on, yeah, I've built my business for so long. What is this kid going to waste his money on? Now, how do you balance that is what if the kid is going crazy, I tell him, look, I can't defend you. Forget it. If he comes up with a good idea, I can convince the father, because he can't, then the father listens, then you go on. So it's very important to remember that your parents have built something in the SME area, or in that area through sheer hard work, and they don't give up so easily. You know, you must respect that. So if you want them to give it up and you've got a good idea, I would say, and of course not me, but use someone in between that has the respect of your parents and you. And then say at least for 1 to 2 years and try and get some idea. It works. We've seen it all over. Some CEOs today just want a mentor, because they don't know who in the team they want to react with. So what does the mentor do, even for international companies or chief executives, is that he keeps the secrecy and he has a chat with him before he can talk to any team member. So it's very important. It's very lonely on the top. Huh? If you think chief executives are having a great time, of course they are, but it's very, very lonely, because every time you discuss something with some of your juniors, they think, hey, you're an idiot, I don't want to work for him. You're scared of that. And therefore, it's important that you learn on ideas. I think the fathers are only worried that my son will waste the money. Either because they don't understand what they do. Digitally, they don't know the business, and they say, I don't know what he's talking about. So start small with him. Show that you're successful. And then the father will say, okay, now, instead of asking him for 100 rupees, ask him for 10. बस मैं अभी कलकत्ते में सिर्फ शुरू करता हूँ, देखिए आप क्या होता है. देन आई विल टेक इट टू बंगाल, देन आई विल टेक इट टू इंडिया. मोस्ट ऑफ द यंगर जनरेशन वॉन्ट टू टेक इट टू इंडिया स्ट्रेट अवे. द फादर, हे व्हाट हैपेंस, नेवर बी एन अभिमन्यु, दैट स्टोरी स्टार्ट्स इन हिज माइंड. सो इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर ऑल ऑफ यू ऑल. And you all have got great ideas, but you know, I always used to say your presentation of an idea is the most. I used to go to board meetings with Danone and everybody else. You think I could talk to them for half an hour on something if in the first 5 minutes I didn't get their attention on the new idea? Forget it. If they got the idea, then they will ask for details. When they ask for details, you got it already. We start at the wrong end of a presentation. I mean, oh boy, I've now had to teach so many people how to make a presentation. They have all the information. They're going to a guy to get money. What is that guy thinking? He's your customer. He's your consumer now. Why are you saying, I'm the greatest, I've got this idea, I've got all that? What does that guy look for? When he wants money, put those slide numbers. I've come with an idea which will make you $1 million. Really? Then he's now listening to the rest. If you keep it as your last slide, he's gone to sleep, and in the end you tell him, I'll make $1 million. Wrong presentation. Very important on how you present. A good idea. A good idea can be thrown away because the boss has lost interest in it in halfway. Simple things, huh? That's all. I mean, everybody ignores because I have a great idea, therefore everybody should love it. Doesn't happen.
What a good solution this is. So before I go to other people also for query, this is my last one. I heard this interview of yours which you gave to ET Now around 3 months ago, and you were talking about the demographic advantage which our country has. Maybe you would like to throw some idea about the opportunities for coming 10 years which we have.
You know, the demographic advantage is that we are a country of entrepreneurs, and I always insist. You know, in Germany, which is supposed to be the most developed or one of the most developed countries in the world, you've got the Mercedes and you've got everything else there. You know how much of contribution do SMEs make there? 87%. Only 13% of Germany is done by the big guys. I went over there saying, I think we are destroying in many ways the entrepreneurial spirit, because the government thinks all young guys are crooks. The young guys think the government guys are crooks. Now that is not an environment in which you can build a strong SME which will then become a large scale business. Okay, because everywhere I go, arey saab, paise de do, kaam ho jayega. Yeah, that's not the way to run a business. You know, and if you see all over the world, what we consider an SME in America is larger than your large scale guy. Now, so it's important on how to build an SME up. All of you all are part of it. As I said, find a niche. Build it in a small place, extend it, grow, and internationally today use digital to be noticed. Everybody who makes a car, why has Toyota come here? Because the bolts are made here, they need bolts, they need somebody to make an axle, they need somebody to do X. Become that first, show your credibility, show your excellence. Don't go to build a car yourself first.
So, now the floor is open for audience. If you have any question, you can ask or maybe I'm sure they have a lot of people. If you don't have, then I still have a lot of left. So. But I still
have. we very well prepared. Friends, anyone for more questions to Mr. Alec, please?
Mike.
Yes, Ravi.
Long back, I saw an interview of Amitabh Bachchan. He was asked, sir, what is the reason of your success? He thought for a while and he said, Bhagya. So, but my question is, we all know luck, without luck, very difficult. But how to get that luck? that is very, very important. Now, how to get that luck or create that luck? We pray, we do good deeds, that's all. That's all in our hands. Pray what? Pray to whom? Pray to God. We don't even know him. And good deeds, we donate, we do good deeds. But will that really ensure luck? We don't know. So what do we do?
You know, I always relate this story of reading great marketing books, and it says if you read that book, you become the number one marketing guy. 1 billion guys read the same book, nobody becomes the greatest marketing guy except the guy who wrote it. So it's important that, I think the question that you are asking is, luck is not something that creates, that you create. Luck doesn't come, it does, perhaps if you pray very well, maybe it will. But it happens to people for some reason or the other. Okay, for even Amitabh Bachchan, whom I know personally, he was the number one actor. Then he collapsed completely and he lost all his money. And he was floundering. And my son-in-law was the CEO of Star at that time. He offered him KBC. Now, and that was his starting point for his coming in. Now, he just walked up to him and they were discussing who to have, Kaun Banega Crorepati at that time. And Rupert Murdoch happened to be there. Now, that's luck. He was visiting India. He said, what are you talking about, Kaun Banega Lakhpati? You have to go Crorepati first. So that was Rupert Murdoch's idea. Who is available? Amitabh Bachchan. If he was a big actor, he wouldn't be available. So sometimes you are in the right place at the right time to do the right thing. So if everyone carries on praying, you know, we have one advantage in the Hindu religion. I'm not a religious person, but unlike all other religions where you have Christ who is the son of God and you have Muhammad who is the son of Allah and all of them, and then they say there's one guy up there, and so do we have. All of us also say there's only one guy on top. But at least we've divided our gods and goddesses into wealth. So if you want VP marketing, you know who to go to. If you want VP strength, you know who to go to. If you want VP wealth, you know who to pray to. Don't try and pray to everyone. Then at least you have, the Hindu religion says, "Acha chalo, aapko tumko paisa chahiye to Lakshmi ke paas jana. Tumko power chahiye to Durga ke paas jana. You want to destroy competition, Kali ke paas jao." Don't try and sort of start praying. You know, that spray and pray idea has to stop. Thinking that something will work. But nothing can take away hard work. Huh? Please, when I say luck is important, everybody who is there, you go and talk to them, he happened to be there at the right time. When Bill Gates and Jobs fought, Steve Jobs wouldn't have left Bill Gates if they hadn't had that fight. Now, who made them fight? I've learned one thing from the Kellogg Dean. His name is Deepak Jain. When I had gone across the marketing in America, he said, remember one thing in life, that we are so much involved in ourselves that on an aircraft, when you're sitting next to a guy whom you don't know, you will tend to read a book and ignore him and go away. He said, never ever think that the person is sitting next to you for no rhyme or reason. Try and talk to him. 5% is that he'll say, don't disturb me or something like that. And then he says that, forget it. 90% of the time the guy will start talking to you, he'll become useful to you 1 year later because you met him on the flight.
Good evening, sir. You talked about Nestle Maggie fiasco. I did a small example. I took a mixture packet from a pawn shop and actually called the customer care officer. It was written 0% cholesterol. So I said, on what basis it was written? So about packaging, how I think government rules will play an important role in future, because anybody is writing anything on the packaging. So any insights on that?
Packaging, what product?
Sir, there was a mixture on the pawn shop. It was written.
That product you're using digital, very good. Because let me tell you, fighting the big brands, first have you got your distribution right? No.
Sir, I think the question was that he said that it was written 0% cholesterol, while that was the wrong information. So what I think Sandeep was trying to ask is, what is the role of the government about controlling the packaging and all that?
Yeah. Okay, sorry, I didn't get the question right. See, what government is becoming very strict now, huh? It's taken them quite some time, and whenever I go to Delhi, I'm part of the standard. Look at what they've done on noodles now. Look at what they're doing on all products. You know, earlier, it was a crazy system in ours that you couldn't launch a product until you got a certification from the government. So you got your plant ready, you got everything ready, and you're waiting for that guy to give you permission. Now they are saying that, no, you start producing. We'll pick up products from the samples from the market whenever we are free. We'll check it out. Are you saying the truth? If not, obviously they go after the big guys first. If Nestle and guys are misleading you, then, you know, Yeah, because even what Piyush Goyal has just said, 100 crores and above, unko to pehle pakdo, tum 5-10 crore kitne log ko tum pakdoge. So they want to catch all the big guys and set an example. Once that example seeps through, but you can make a complaint about that guy if you want, huh? If he's saying 0% cholesterol and you've had it, because we were getting away with it. You know how much of arrowroot is put into thin arrowroot biscuits? We got away with it in Britannia. Just a dash. Today you have to put, at when you call a product fat-free, it has to be less than 3% fat. Lower fat, everybody low fat they write, and at the back you read it's lower than the, this guy who's selling 15% minus 7%, so I'm lower fat. How many people have looked at the back of a canned Coke, Diet Coke? It says don't give it to children below 12 years. How many of us read? They are saying, we've told everybody, you are still carrying on, go ahead and do it. But digital will help you in the sense that you can make a digital complaint today, complain, and let's see what happens to that guy. How can he say zero cholesterol in a bhujia? I mean, doc, is it possible? I mean, does anyone, the consumer has to be an idiot to believe that in the first place.
All right, friends. Can someone please circulate the mic here?
So going to the history of Britannia,
yeah.
We understand that Britannia started in Calcutta.
Correct.
It was a small factory which started with an investment of 260 rupees or 264 rupees,
yeah, yeah.
By Mr. Gupta. And then he took up the, you know, the next level, and he had a factory in Mumbai. And Calcutta was the headquarters. Today, Bangalore is the headquarters. And we are still having a very big unit of Britannia in Calcutta. So how do you suggest, as a geographical area and as a culture of Calcutta, how do we cope up better to, you know, be the first what we were? Now, we would like to be in the run. And I would request you to suggest us, how do we compete as a geographical area? What is good about us?
You know, the number one biscuit in Bengal is Bisk Farm. How many of you know that? And he was a distributor first for Britannia. Then he became a contract packer, Mr. Paul. Then one son-in-law from Nestle joined him. And he said, and Britannia then threw him out saying, you're a useless contract packer. So he went to the Calcutta, all the guys who retired from the Britannia factory he hired. He made a fantastic product in Bengal, because they were making the Britannia product, and they made the same product at a lower price. But now he doesn't have to charge that lower price. You know, you can use a low price or a packaging for an entry point, but if you think that is sustainable in the long run, it never happens. So I began the ad, but if you either don't have the money or the capacity, think small. Become number one or number two at least in one city before you move out. If you're number five all over India, how does that help you? You have to be a threat to all the big guys at least in one state first. You know, there's one, I go abroad, one state in India is equal to France. Does everybody want to launch in Europe overnight? They first become number one in France. Why don't we become one in UP, one in Bengal before we go anywhere? Look at the number of consumers you have. Arey yaar, wo to only Bengal mein chal raha. So what? I'm the most successful guy. I'm not an Indian. I'm not pan-India as yet. But big bazaars and all these chains are offering you an opportunity. You can focus on regular distribution in one state and yet be available in big bazaar in 26 states. Pay them a little bit money, they'll put it on the right shelf, see that it's, you know, eye level, and then that's it. You don't have to have any sales guys, you don't have to have any overheads, nothing.
So taking that question ahead in terms of productivity, you have handled so many people in Britannia, and now also you are consulting with so many people in the organizations. How do we improve productivity of employees in the organization? Any specific case you want to mention that you did?
From your learnings, yes, I think that would be more better. I mean, how did you manage manpower?
You know, I think the biggest obstruction to any development or innovation is senior management. Young guys come with great ideas, and it doesn't reach the CEOs. The senior guys are bakwas. You know, it's what are you talking about? That poor fellow goes back. I introduced in Britannia a thing called the opportunity manager, and it was at that time, I think I introduced in 2000, if I'm not mistaken, just 3 years before I left with the HR head. What I said was that look, anybody in the company, whether it's a marketing guy, factory guy, any age, whatever, thinks of an idea, let him present it to the HR head. And the HR head will look at, you know, and I said, don't think for strategy. That's not your job. Give me a 12 month that you, if I give you the money for this, you're earning 10 rupees. What will you earn at the end of 12 months if I give that to you? And what I did with that, and therefore, if we accept that opportunity, he becomes the head. And I said, you can pick 3 guys from the organization to be part of your team. And I give you one specific example which worked. One guy said, I'm going to make a cream biscuit. And he was a marketing guy, product manager, he had just joined. So he said, I want the head of R&D, vice president, to be part of me because I don't know how to make the biscuit. And the factory manager, where it's going to be made, should also report to me. These guys were 3 levels and 4 levels above him. And the marketing head, when I want to launch it in Bengal. Now here's a product manager who has been allowed to pick a team. And the senior guys, if they didn't report to him, he could come to me and I'd take their pants off. Simple. It took exactly 1 year. I said, I have this resource. I used to get the marketing team to come. I had Sachin Tendulkar. I had Rahul Dravid as brand. I had number of brand ambassadors. Everyone wanted Tendulkar. Give it to me. I'll do it. I said, okay, I'm giving it to you. How will you use it? I'll use this. All of them used to compete for the resource available. So Saurav Ganguly went on to Tiger because he was Tiger of Bengal, and also they delivered the results. What happened was, if they deliver the results at the end of the year, you gave them a cash prize, and the opportunity manager divided it between based on what he thought. You contributed 10%, you'll get only 10%. So it took some time, but there are many ideas where you will not let the younger people in your organization die with the idea because the middle management is killing it. Yesterday I was at the ITC, I was not at the AGM, but I happened to be here, so Yogi and I joined ITC together at that time. So there was an idea which, there's some ice cream company up for sale. So I went and met the head. The new CEO is Sanjeev Puri, I think, right? He said, it hasn't even come to him, it's already got rejected. I said, what are you talking about? That guy is gone. He said, really? Please send it to me, at least we'll take another look. So the middle management manager said, nah, nah, we are buying Horlicks and all, so this doesn't fit. I said, you're getting into dairy. How can you say it doesn't fit into your strategy? He said, you're so right. So it struck me again that it hasn't even moved up. That junior guy said, cancelled it. So it's very, very important that we do it.
Wow. That's a great reply. Any other question? We still have a lot of time, as understood by you. So.
Good evening, sir. Okay. I am Piyush. Sir, but like you said that you had a vision statement like every third Indian should use the brand by 2004. What if a brand like Patanjali would have entered that market in that time? And wasn't that a very big risk you were taking? Because if a market brand like Patanjali enters into the market, and what would we have be your plan B?
Okay, you're asking if I was still in Britannia. No, you know what we used to have in Britannia, which I think for some reason they stopped. There used to be every year, I used to have a section saying, what are the threats to your company? At that time, Nabisco Oreo was a threat, which is now Cadbury's have come in with that product because Mondelez has launched it. So we had launched a product called Pure Magic. We were the first guys to launch it. I said, launch it now. They've launched, study where they go all over the world. Oreo and Ritz crackers were the two products that Nabisco would use. So we had our snacks and we had our this thing saying that the moment they enter, I'm going to match their price, I'm going to kill them. I don't think after. So I don't know whether it still exists in the company or not. That you'll have to ask the new CEO. Today, and you must be at least 1% ahead of market growth, otherwise you lose market share. See, market share for me is like a farmer who's got land. In famine, if you start selling the land, then when the rain comes, you have that much less to do. Protect your market share at the drop of a profit also in a year which is bad. Because the good times will come and you'll have a larger base to grow on. A lot of people say, I want profitability, I want profits, let me lose a 1%. It's very difficult to get, as you said, get back that market share. Not that people haven't got it, but it's not easy. So that's another learning. I mean, you're dragging me out of a number of things free of cost, like what he's doing. These are normally paid for ideas. But that's what I'm, I don't know what, today the market is growing, India is growing, Britannia is the only company listed, they've lost, Parle is the number one brand now. I never allowed Parle to become number one brand. They were number one in glucose biscuits, volume wise I said bhool jao. But I'm, you know, it hurts me to say Britannia has allowed Parle to go ahead of them. And yet they've got profits, they've got growth, shares are going up. Because it's the only biscuit company in the market. Tomorrow, if Parle comes into the stock market, will you buy Parle or will you buy Britannia? You have to think of all these things, you know. So, very easy to confuse everybody with your growth.
Yeah, Mr.
Amin. Good evening, sir. Shombit Sengupta sends his regards for you. I'm an advertising filmmaker and I've also made about close to a dozen films for Britannia, both at the national level and at the local level. So my question is, because I work with a lot of SMEs and I try to convince them, what do you think, how important is a product video right now in the given the current market mix and advertising mix?
How important is product?
Product video.
Video?
Product video. Yeah.
See, I don't know what you mean by video, because if you've got money to spend on advertising, get your distribution right first. Because the moment a person sees an ad and goes to buy it and your product is not available, you're wasting money. Get your distribution right, get your packaging right, get your price right. Then viral market on digital or based on your money. It becomes important only when all the infrastructure is ready to take it. You can buy the best aircraft, but if your airport can't take it, what's the use? So I think I would say that is the last step after you've got everything right, to then create a proper content. And if people want humor at that time, or they want, I've always found about a house, unless of course it's medicine, but even that now with Viagra and all, you see great funny ads coming up. But all I'm saying is that look, virally it only goes if there's humor. And I don't mean slapstick humor or ha-ha humor, which you, if you don't, all the ads that I ran have a little bit of humor, because people will remember what they saw. And you know, you're not a, you know, I always used to tell a guy, if you're a CEO and you're speaking about increments and all, everybody's listening to you, because hamara kab turn aayega ye wo and all that. But then anybody else is talking, the other guys are talking to each other, because you're irrelevant. So remain relevant in someone's life, then they'll listen to you. The moment you become irrelevant, forget it. Unless of course you're the owner and he feels you're going to sack him, then of course it's a dip. But then you're a monopoly, which is very rare.
So you answer your question, will answer? Yeah.
Hello. We have been talking about startups are bleeding a lot and nobody is looking for profit. But if you see in last 15 years, we have seen over 50% of the Fortune 500 companies either have gone bankrupt or ceased to exist or are no more in even top 1,000 lists. So where do you see they making mistakes? Because they have big management and everything.
You know, you're so right. Take a look at where Sony is today, where Sony was earlier, because they go to sleep. You know, complacency sets in when you're a market leader. That's the first thing you have to stop avoiding. So that, look, I cannot become complacent. And there are many brands which have lasted for years also. So study from them how they've done it. IBM said, I'm the biggest. I will not get into all these laptops and all, it doesn't work. Xerox died. because they never went into all the adjacent disruptions taking place. What has Apple done when I came out, four guys came out with that little thing, they've now launched it. Within 2 years, an Apple One which connects onto your phone, which connects you onto the main, they've connected everything in Apple. Now compete with them. But if they are sitting back and saying, oh, just a wristband, we'll kill you. Now wristband gives you your heartbeat. It gives you your blood pressure. It only began with how many steps are you taking. And look at it, that small thing, they are now attaching your health thing. So more hospitals can get attached to it. Every time I go to Beach Candy, they want to take, I say, no, give me a thing, give it to me, feed it in. And they say, the moment this goes up, come to see me. You know, the question that I keep asking, everybody wants to do research on various things. And I told my wife, who's also a medical doctor, and we've got doctors here. You know, the art of researching and spending money on everything is like saying, achha, tum X-ray bhi karalo, blood test bhi karalo, you spend your money, then I'll tell you what's wrong with you. That GP, the general practitioner concept of understanding you as a person, as a consumer, as a family, he would first know that your cough and cold is heading for a fever or not. But today, the youngsters are just saying that, do your X-ray, do your blood test, and look at it, over. So that little art, I mean, I was asked to address Levers. They used to do research before they launched a product. When it was successful, they will do another research to see whether, I said, I don't have that much money. I'd rather spend that money advertising my product. Tiger was launched with zero research. Huh? If I ever talk to you all about Tiger, zero research. Not one rupee I could spend on research. Packaging, brand name, biscuit, everything was done with zero research. That was luck. Somebody was asking me, oh, luck. I was lucky that it worked. But at that point of time, we were struggling to, Parle G was number one. And every time in Britannia, we launched Britannia glucose D, vitamin C. The consumer said, nahi, wo glucose biscuit meant Parle. So you're banging your head against a wall. When did I learn about Tiger? When I got sacked the first time, I was out for 1 year. I didn't even know whether I'll go back to Britannia during Rajan Pillay's time. So for that 1 year, I sat back and I said, if I ever get a chance of going back to Britannia, what was I doing wrong? What should I do now? And that same biscuit, without mentioning it as glucose, was launched as Tiger. But when we did it, the team will always come and tell you, sir, we'll run Glucose D also, we'll run Tiger also, we'll run Circus also. And as the other brands dry, this will come out. I told the factory earlier, no more Glucose D, no more Circus, no sales guy knew that I'd already done it. They had only Tiger to sell. We were selling a total of, I think, 14,000 tons of Glucose D and Circus together against 100,000 tons of Parle. We sold 27,000 tons in the first year. It became a 100 crore brand in 2005, which is one of the most successful. But there, a lot of luck. I mean, I was sure that I'm doing the right packaging, which mother doesn't want her child to be a tiger, which young kid doesn't want to be a tiger. You were going on being a general practitioner. Before you do your X-rays, before you do your blood test, you understood your consumer. So to that extent, you're right. But then, after that, luck comes in. I've had failures also, obviously. But have 2-3 successes, now that you're a successful guy. Your failures will carry. Always.
Friends, with paucity of time, I think we'll have last question now. Yeah, please. Okay. Sorry, just last two. Krishna.
Checked it a little bit on internet and it said that this ad has been created by Coke in 2013 and it was launched in America in 2013.
So, one second, so many people create ads, and when it gets, then of course you're not going to run it. So somebody pulled it out and run it at the wrong time. How will I tell you don't eat Britannia biscuits?
No,
just think logically.
That's what I was wondering about. Maybe to try to avoid some class action suit or something.
5 years later, some guy stolen the ad and run it. Coke would never put up an ad like that itself.
Okay.
I have to decry their own. They are going around saying they've understood that carbonated drinks are down. So they are selling water and fresh juices and all to compensate. That they are doing. If the consumer themselves are knocking out Pepsi and Coke and all drinking and they are moving into bottled water and everything else on their own. But I don't think any company will say, please, they will say, drink whatever you like. We are putting up, but don't. How are they saying that? So there are enough fake ads also. You have to double check very quickly. And I think it's the response of a company that should come out very quickly. This is not my ad. But they couldn't do it because it was lying with them, but they were never planning to run it.
So, right, one last question. So, Pratanjali is a relatively new brand comparison to Britannia or IDC. So, where do you see Pratanjali 5 years from now? Do you think they will become number one? Because they will do very aggressive marketing.
I think if they have advisors like me, they might.
Follow-up question is, are you advising them?
I'm advising a biscuit which is called Premika in the north, and it's a fund which has put about 500 crores into the company. It's a private fund, and with a plan of going in for an IPO. It's one of the private, I don't know when they'll go in. And I represent the fund on that company with my team to say how, if we put in sales and whatever what it was 3 years ago, how are you going to build it? So we worked out a strategy for them, and we worked out a number of things for them, and hopefully, again, if luck plays a role, the fund will make money, because when they go into the market, whenever they decide. So we have an opportunity there.
Sir, I want to have my last say, and I want to ask the last question. Okay.
Okay, yours will be the last.
I'll be the last.
So yours will be the last, all right. Can you use the mic?
Yeah. I want job work, because I like the Britannia Time Pass biscuit a lot. Sometimes I eat that biscuit. Two biscuits are totally different. One is, you don't feel any oil on your hand, and when you take the another one, you can feel a lot of oil. So then I console myself, being a manufacturer myself, I also do a lot of job work. So, I think that if Britannia is a company that doesn't control its job, then we're fine.
You know, that is why Parle has become the number one brand. Because they have lost...
But sir, my question is it, Britannia is finding it hard to keep a tie on job work quality?
No. There was no question. You must be a CEO who says quality comes first. I cannot... You don't have to be the best. Quality restaurants spelled K-W-A-L-I-T-Y. You go anywhere in India, they serve the same food, same price. It's not the best food. It's the consistency. Like what you're taught, the shape is the same. Their chana will be the same. Their bhatura will be the same. The recipe is the same. So the customer knows when he walks in what to expect. And when you start buying Britannia during my time, I'd have killed them. Every job work factory had a quality manager from Britannia posted there. Not a single biscuit moved out without him seeing it. I don't know today whether that family business is more interested in making money, so they don't give a damn. Yeah? Everything is growing, let it be. But one of the reasons why Parle has become number one is that. How have they beaten Britannia? Today, if you read Economic Times and all, it has become the number one brand. And it horrifies me. It shouldn't have happened. But today, they will. How do they make more money? Their Good Day biscuits, if you compare to when I launched it and now, they've reduced the fat, they've reduced, become dry. So I'm advising Premika to come out with the old recipe and we'll stew them in the north. That's it. They're not interested anymore in the CEO. Whenever I have a CEO, they're more interested in showing Nasli Wadia that I've made more money for you.
So friends, the last question is the person who began this. So Vivek.
So my question is that do you have any, when do we see you in a mainstream politics sometime? Because we see you quite active and your debates are really, really, really amusing when you are
I have no intentions. I am not a member of any political party. I want to state that quite openly. But I thought, and I still, Modi was the guy that needed the support in 2013, because everybody was kind of Manmohan Singh and Congress and everything else. I said, here's a person who's coming, and I decided to support him on television. I wasn't paid for it. I've got nothing. He asked me, you want to join BJP? I said, no, I could have gone into elections. Much better to have power from outside than inside. I've always lived on that.
Me and Uncle was talking about this. He said that I'm not the king, I'm the kingmaker. So you know.
No. I'm not any kingmaker. But the point remains that if I go into a government office today, they listen to me because they think I'm close. They think I'm not. Works. You work it for your business now. That's important. And you asked me the last question. I'll tell you one thing about one little funny story before I end. Now that you got me going. You know, it's your core strength which is most important. So even when I go on television, I never support BJP blindly. I never support any. I give my point of view, which should be logical. You may not agree with me, but I don't like this cow ban. I eat beef. I'm a Hindu. So what? Yeah. There's all this rubbish going on, but it's you criticize it. You know, but do you know why India is always, the South, especially the South, have always produced great spinners in cricket, since cricket is it. And this is the funny story, it's not real, but I mean, you know, because have you ever seen a South Indian eat? He's constantly eating like this, as a kid. So he produces the great spinners. So one guy asked me, when I said it, but Bishan Singh Bailey, one of the greatest spinners from the North, I said, because he wore his pagdi like that all the time. So that's it.
Friends, believe me, he's much more wittier than what he has been today, because I've been had number of interactions with him. He's still on that very subsided side today. So with this, we end our Q&A, and thank you so much. And I would request my fellow ICBN member Natwar to please address a thank you note.
Hi friends, I think I'm clear, audible, everybody can hear me. And what a great session, sir, what a great session. Nobody could go out. I could see everybody sitting here listening to you continuously. I think nobody took a new break also. So I think let's have a loud applause for sir. He could keep the audience engaged. He could keep the audience listening to him continuously. Sir, you're a great speaker. We learned a lot from you. We learned how to speak. We learned even if things are not working accordingly, how to manage situations and then also be the best. Thank you very much for coming all the way, giving us this insight, teaching us how to take our companies forward. We are young, we are dynamic, but we have power from you, we have knowledge from you, we can grow multiple companies. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. I would like to thank you again for all the questions and answers which you have really delivered. You have answered everybody the way you people wanted to hear. And every question answered was really, really beautifully taken forward, and everybody got the answer right. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Everyone wants to, you know, it's a digital thing which has been started on fashion and logistics and everything else. The one who sent me the whole thing, do they know the difference between
Instagram? Do they know the difference between this, which is running? I asked her, I said, I'm not, but she is, my elder one uses, she's a great production person, ABC, coffee with color, she manages costs, she's a terrific. One son-in-law is the head of, he was the head of Starburst, the one who got ABC, Sameer Nair. And then he's now heading Kumarabhanu Birla's applause thing, where they are producing for content for the television and Netflix kind of movies, not movies per se, but for television and for this. So I've got a family of digital people who I rely on, but I'm too old for learning at the moment. So you just chill and relax. Anytime you're in a problem, you ask them a question, they'll send it.
Friends, on the note that Natwar was mentioning, I would take this platform to request Mr. Alad that he's been mentoring FICCI and many organizations. So ICBI is a very nascent stage. They're just 7-month-old baby. So I would really request you on this platform to, you know, kind of mentor us as an ICBI mentor. So and so that we can keep your guidance, keep getting your guidance.
Absolutely. I learn every day from the younger generation. Anywhere that I can be used. I mean, don't think I'm used. I might use you in learning what is happening.
So friends, we have officially an ICBI mentor today. So bless us. Thank you.
I would request everybody to thank each other. We are the strength. If we combine together, we can form a forum where people can look upon us. People can say, yes, are you an ICBN? Yes, wow, you're an ICBN. Can I join ICBN? Yes, you can. Yes, you can. Let's together promise each other that we will grow together. We are the best in our field, but together we can become the best. So let's try to become the best with ICBN. Together we can grow. Let's grow, friends, and that's our motive. That's why we are here. To grow, grow, and grow. Together we can grow. Let's promise that. We have a group picture, so I would request everybody for a group picture. Sir, please be with us for the group picture so that we can take the memory home and show that yes, we were with you and we have learned a lot of things to our wives also. Next, we have an IT outside, so please join us, everybody. We'll all be on there. Yeah, we can have the layers here.